Good afternoon, students. Yesterday we have done the periodic table S block and P block. We have learned about the elements of S block, P block, and T block, all the elements which are present in periodic table. So let's continue with the same topic. Today we will learn about the properties of different blocks, and we will learn about the elements which are present in different blocks, exceptions, and unique properties related to the specific block group, okay, related to specific period and to the specific block. So here is the your periodic table. This is S block, the right side one is P block, this middle one is D block, and the lower block which is placed below the periodic table is F block. Okay, so let's just I think we have discussed this thing already. This thing is given here, the number of shells, means the shells which are participating, the outermost shell which are participating in the electron filling. In S, we have this description, when we go down the group, the shell will increase, means principal quantum number will increase. This is N1, N2, N3, N4, N5, N6, N7. S is the outermost shell. In P, 2P, 3P, 4P, 5P, 6P, 7P. And for D is like 3D, 4D, 5D, 6D. These are the shells in which the filling of electrons will take place. Means they are the outermost shells which take part in electron filling. Okay. So let's just discuss about the electronic configuration and types of elements. What are the elements which are present in these specific blocks? Okay. So the Auerbach principle. Auerbach principle. This principle we have learned in our previous chapter. So what was the Auerbach principle? He clearly stated about the electron filling definition, means how you can fill the electrons in the element, in the in subshells. So what is the procedure? Okay, so he just dictated the manner in which the electrons are filled in the atomic orbital of an atom, right, in its ground state. We are talking about the ground state, means at that this state, the number of electrons will be the same. But in excited state, what happened? Sometimes the electrons jump from lower energy level to higher energy level. Sometimes it donates the electrons, sometimes it accepts the electrons. So Auerbach gave a proper description about the electron filling, how the electron filling takes place in subshell. Okay, so it stated that the electrons are filled in the atomic orbital in the increasing order of energy level. Right, means in the increasing order of energy level from lower energy level to higher one. For example, if we talk about this electronic configuration of cesium, so what is happening here? First, the lower energy level orbital should be filled, means you have to completely fill the lower energy level orbital, then we'll go to the higher one. So first 1s2, this s is complete, 2s2, this s is complete, 2p6, this is filled, and we'll go on further. Okay, so this is the basic formula, basic the base of the Auerbach principle which was explained by him. Okay, so this procedure will be followed for the electronic configuration of the element. So let's just talk about S block elements. What are S block elements? The elements which are present in S block, the first group, the first one, the lithium family, that is known as alkali metals. The second group are known as alkali earth metals. Alkali metals have NS1. N is the shell. Okay, principal quantum number. If you're talking about our first shell, then 1s will be there. If you're talking about the second, 2s will be there. Okay, so this NS1 is for alkali metals, and alkali earth metal is NS2. Because in that, we have the electrons in outermost shell are 2. Okay, so these electronic configurations belong to S block. So in these elements, among all these elements, the outermost electron readily forms the plus 1 ion or plus 2 ion. Means if they have in first shell, we have one unpaired electron, so plus 1 ion will be there because it has only one electron to share, to make bond, to attain a stable state. So metals has this property to donate the electron, that is why, and they have only one electron to donate, plus one will be there. And for the alkali earth metal, the plus two ion will be formed. Okay, So metallic characters and the reactivity increases as we go down the group. As we go down to the group, the metallic property increases. Means the, for example, if we talk about lithium, so lithium is reactive metal. It is an exception in that block actually, because these are actually predominantly ions means these are generally exist in ionic form mostly, right? So lithium is highly reactive. Let's just go to sodium. Sodium is also reactive. That is why we used to keep it in kerosene, because it generally react with the atmospheric oxygen at room temperature. When we go to the potassium, this is also the reactive. Okay, so there, when we go down to the group, the metallic property of the element increase. Okay, so because of high reactivity, they are never found in pure. They are highly reactive elements. That is why these elements don't found in the nature in pure form. They generally found in oxide form, sulfide form, right? So these, the compound of S block element, with the exception of those lithium and beryllium. Lithium and beryllium are the head of their families, are known as predominantly ionic. Predominantly ion means, pre means primitive. Dominantly means they are actually in ionic form. So predominantly ionic means they are like mainly they occur in ionic state, not in solid state, not in other state. They generally, these beryllium and lithium generally occur in the ionic state. They generally found in nature in ionic form. So let's just go to P block elements. The P block elements are from 13 group to 18 group. Okay. So if we combine S block and P block elements, all the elements which are present in first and second group along with 13 to 18 group are known as representative elements or main group elements. Okay. So the outermost shell, the electronic configuration is obviously ns1 and 2p1. It go from to this np1 to np6, because the start electron filling start from the one electron and it reaches to the six for the noble gases, because this is the completely filled shell. Okay, so the elements which have ns2 2p6 electronic configuration, these are known as noble gases, because they are generally unreactive. They do not react, they do not participate in any chemical reaction, because they do not require any electron to fulfill their octet, and they don't have excess electron to donate it. Okay, so they are inactive gases. The noble gases are thus exhibit very low chemical reactivity. They are chemically inactive, we can say. Generally, they are chemically inactive. So if we talk about the halogen group is the fluorine family. Okay, and the oxygen group is known as chalcogen group is oxygen family, halogen group is fluorine family. So if we talk about the halogen, so that is 17 group fluorine family, and chalcogen, this is 16 group, and that is oxygen family. So these two groups of elements have highly negative electron gain enthalpy. Electron gain enthalpy means we will discuss when we go to the periodic property. This thing I will explain you what is electron gain enthalpy. Okay, so it's readily an add-on one or two electron respectively to attain the stable noble gas configuration. So they require, the 16 group require only two electrons to attain the noble gas configuration, and 17 group require one electron to attain the noble gas electronic configuration. Okay, so we have done with the P block. Let's just go to the D block. What is the basic property of D block elements? So these are the elements from 3 to 12, scandium to the 12th group. Okay, so what will happen? This exists in the center of the periodic table between S and P. Okay, so the characteristics of filling d orbital, because d orbital participate in the electron filling, that is why these elements are known as d block elements. They are generally metals actually. Okay, in this group all the elements which are present in d block are metals. They are mostly form color ions, exhibit variable valencies. The variable valencies means there the is the valency is not actually specific. If we talk about valency of oxygen, what is the valency of oxygen? Yes, beta, what is the valency of oxygen? Am I audible? Yes, what is the valency of oxygen?
-2.
-2. It's not 2. Someone has written in the chat box 2. That is not 2. You're talking about the means the only electron. We are when we talk about valence, then at that time we have to mention the charge on the element, that is plus or minus. So -2 is the valency of oxygen. But in these D block elements, the specific, the valency is actually variable. They change their valency according to the reaction. Okay, and they have a special property, that is paramagnetism. What is known as paramagnetism? Paramagnetism elements are those which behave like magnet when we put them in the magnetic field, but do not retain the magnetic characteristics. अगर हम इनको किसी मैग्नेटिक पोल के बीच में रखेंगे एट दैट टाइम दे बिहेव लाइक मैग्नेट्स बट व्हेन वी रिमूव देम फ्रॉम द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड दे जस्ट बिहेव लाइक एज अ नॉर्मल एलिमेंट दे डू नॉट रिटेन एनी परमानेंट मैग्नेटिज्म गॉट इट इफ वी प्लेस दीज एलिमेंट्स इन द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड देन दे बिहेव लाइक मैग्नेट बट व्हेन वी रिमूव व्हेन वी जस्ट रिमूव दीज एलिमेंट्स फ्रॉम द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड दे डू नॉट रिटेन एनी मैग्नेटिक प्रॉपर्टी दे जस्ट कम टू देयर ओरिजिनल प्रॉपर्टी सो दिस इज द स्पेशल कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ दीज एलिमेंट्स मैग्नेटिज्म एंड अफिनिटी ओके सो लेट्स जस्ट टॉक अबाउट द अदर प्रॉपर्टीज व्हिच आर रिलेटेड टू द डी ब्लॉक एलिमेंट्स ऑफनली यूज एज कैटलिस्ट कैन वन ऑफ यू टेल मी व्हाट यू मीन बाय कैटलिस्ट
Ma'am, anything which is used to increase the rate of reaction without getting participated in the reaction.
Yes, but it is not restricted to only increase the rate of reaction. Sometimes some reactions are endothermic and we have to provide heat as well as a catalyst to initiate the reaction. So these elements are generally used as catalysts sometimes to initiate the reaction. Sometimes to increase the rate of reaction, right? So catalyst, so D block elements are used as catalyst in so many reactions. Oftenly they are used as catalyst because of their property of variable valency and some specific property which is different from D block and P block and S block. So however, zinc, cadmium and mercury, which have the electronic configuration N1 D10S2 NS2 means the outermost electron are filled, outermost shell are filled, do not show most of the properties of the transition element. Since zinc, cadmium and mercury, they generally have the completely filled electronic configuration shells. Okay, so they do not show most properties which are related to these transition elements. So these are the exceptions. Okay. So in the same way, transition metals form a bridge between the chemical activities of metals of S block and the least active elements of 13 to 14 group, thus take familiar name as transition elements. So these are as the bridge which exists between the S block and P block elements. So that is why these are known as transition elements. But there is another block which is present inside the transition element after lanthanum and actinium. These are known as F block elements. Okay, this group start after, these groups are known as lanthanoids and actinium. Okay, this group start from atomic number 58 to 71 in lanthanoids, and in actinoids it start from 90 to 103. So the electronic configuration is this. Means the last electron added to each element is filled in F block. That is why this block is known as F block. Okay. This series is known as inner transition elements because it plays inside the transition elements. In this, all the elements which are present there, all are metals. Generally. okay, they all are metals. But we do have exceptions already. So within each series, the property of elements are quite similar. The chemistry of early actinoids is most complicated than the corresponding to lanthanoids. But there is a difference in actinoids and lanthanoids too. Okay, the elements which present in lanthanoids are different from the actinoids. So why this property is there? Due to the large number of oxidation state possible for these actinoids elements, the actinoids elements are called radioactive. So actinoid elements, the elements which are present in actinoid series, these elements are known as the radioactive elements. Why? Because there are a number of oxidation state possible, right? So these are known as radioactive elements. So many of the actinoids elements has been only in nanogram quantity or even less by nuclear reaction, and their chemistry is not fully studied, because the chemistry, the properties are not fully studied about these actinoids because they are highly reactive. Okay, they shows a vigorous, they can show a vigorous reaction if you take in nanograms. So they just explain this thing that these are radioactive elements. When they exposure to some other source of energy, they just blow it up and shows a nuclear reaction there. So that is why these elements are known as radioactive elements. Okay, so the elements which are after uranium are known as transuranium elements. So when we talk about the elements which comes after uranium, uranium is most radioactive element. Okay, so these elements, the elements which are present after the uranium, these are known as transuranium elements. Okay, so you have to learn the basic things which are related to these specific groups. So let's just talk about all the elements which are present in these blocks. That these are combinedly metals, non-metals, and metalloids. So in the periodic table, in the periodic table, 78% of the elements are metals when we move from left to right. So the elements which are present in nature most comprises of metals, that is 78%. So generally metals are solid at room temperature, exception mercury, gallium, and cesium. They have lowest melting and boiling point. Okay, so that is why these are exceptions, because metals generally has high melting and boiling point. Okay, cesium is that metal which is used in solar panels. When we talk about solar panel, na, solar cooker, solar inverter. So in solar panel sheet, the sheet which we placed on the roof, in that we have cesium metals. Okay. So metal usually have high melting boiling point, good conductor, malleable, ductile, and non-metal shows different property from the metals. They are present at the right side of the periodic table. Okay, generally these are powdered or gaseous or liquid form, they exist, but generally they have low melting point, but exception is boron and carbon. Boron has different melting point, and carbon, since it has three isotopes and all three isotopes shows different properties. Non-metals are poor conductor of electricity, but graphite is the best conductor. Non-metals are the soft elements, but exception is diamond. It is the hardest element which is present on earth. Okay, so we have so many exceptions here. Okay, non-ductile, non-sonorous, non-malleable. So if we talk about the metalloids, so metalloids are the elements which shows like properties similar to metals and non-metals both. That is why these are known as semi-metals or metalloids. Okay. So sometimes when they react with metals, they will behave like non-metals. When they react with non-metals, they will behave like metals. Okay. So they are present in a zigzag line in P block. So the metalloids are silicon, germanium, arsenic, antimony, and this tellurium. Okay, so these are the non-metals which are present in a zigzag line in P block. So today we have done about the properties of the elements, right? So let's just you just tell me, can you name a metal, a non-metal which is highly reactive to the atmospheric oxygen. Name a non-metal which is highly reactive to the oxygen, atmospheric oxygen. That is why we used to keep it somewhere, store in somewhere.
Phosphorus.
Yes. So like metals, we do have exception in non-metals also, which are highly reactive. In metals, we have lithium, sodium, potassium. These are highly reactive. Okay. And if we talk about non-metals, the phosphorus is highly reactive. Red phosphorus is actually exists in two forms. Red phosphorus and white phosphorus. Okay. They both are highly reactive. And the use of, can you tell me where phosphorus is used? The use of phosphorus. On matchstick and matchbox. Right? The matchstick or matchbox ke upar jo jisko hum bolte hain, like the substance which is present on the sides of the matchbox and in the back top of the matchstick. So that is phosphorus. And some mixed thing, glass and so many things are there. But the main ingredient is phosphorus, red and white. Okay? So